So the next part of this video is going to be about bones. First of all, a good corset should not affect the natural position of your spine. I'm going to repeat this because it's very important. A good corset should not affect the position of your spine. If you find that your corset is creating pressure on your back to cause you to hunch forward or hunch back or hunch to either side unnaturally, it is not a well-formed corset. Throughout history, you can see some S-curve or Edwardian corsets in which the front of the body is thrust forward and the back of the body is thrust back. And what this has actually caused is sway back in a lot of the young girls who used to wear these corsets. Personally, I would never wear an Edwardian corset. I think they're quite beautiful, but I would not wear one because I don't want those types of risks on my balance and all my skeleton, because that can cause further orthopedic problems in the future. If you must wear one, only wear it occasionally, not every day. So most people have 24 ribs. Like teeth, some people have a couple more, some people have a couple less. But generally, most people have 24, 12 on each side, and they stretch from basically right underneath the clavicle to almost the point of the waist. And the last two pairs, or the last four at the bottom, are called floating ribs. And what those are, they're attached at the spine by some cartilage joints, but they do not come up and meet at the sternum like the other ribs do. And actually, these two last floating ribs, they're too small to actually really protect any of the soft tissues inside of your torso. So some people think that they're not really necessary. In fact, when some people need reconstructive surgery on small areas like their face, surgeons will often take those small floating ribs and use it for extra bone material for reconstructing the small bones. So a corset will never actually affect all of the ribs, because usually corsets never come right up to the clavicle. The ribs that are going to be affected the most are the two smallest pairs of the floating ribs at the bottom. And what actually happens then is because those floating ribs are so flexible, they can actually expand out and they can contract in when you're breathing, then you can afford to actually restrict them by an inch or two without fear of having them break. One thing I wanted to remind you about is that bones are living tissue. They are not dead, unbendable rocks or anything like that. When you put a lot of pressure on them at once, they will break. But if you put gentle, consistent pressure on a bone, then it will eventually bend over many months or years. Now, there are two ways that this is thought to happen. The first way is just basically a bending of the cells. They're just kind of like one side is stretching and the other side is almost contracting or getting denser, and then the bones curl over like this. Another way is a kind of dynamic equilibrium in the bone. There are two main types of cells on a bone. There's osteoblasts. I like to think of it as blast, starting with B, means they build bone, and osteoclasts. And I think of class meaning kind of, you know, it starts with C, the same way as catabolism, so it breaks down bone. So if you imagine that this is a rib, if you put constant pressure on it, then what will happen is it'll send a signal to those osteoclasts at the outer edge here to start breaking down the bone and absorbing it back into the body. And then it will also send a signal on the bottom here for the osteoblasts to start building up the bone, so that over time it'll kind of go like this and move downward or inward rather, in response to the stress that's pushing on it that way, so that the bones will maintain their general kind of size and their density, but they're moving inwards. So I need to make a note about young people doing corseting. The younger you are, the less actual hard bone you have and the more cartilage you have. Cartilage is a lot softer, it's more flexible, it bends more easily, and if it happens to break, it actually mends more easily as well. This is why in traditional ancient China they had foot binding, and they would often start that foot binding on young girls who are in their very early childhood. Also, in some places of Africa and South America, certain tribes would actually bind the skulls of little babies to make their heads grow long, like almost like cone heads. This is because the younger you are, the more moldable your body is. However, I do not recommend at all for young people to start corseting. A lot of people, you know, in Western Europe, hundreds of years ago, they would start corseting when they were about 12 years old, maybe, in order to get those little itty-bitty 16-inch waists. But I cannot see how corseting at that young an age could help you at all. This is a very passionate subject for me because I don't want anybody to get hurt. So I do not recommend that you start corseting until you're at least out of your teens. When I was in undergrad, I actually gained an inch in height, so I was not done my growing even by the time I was about 20 years old. So I implore you, I beseech you to just be patient and wait until you're done growing, because you could seriously warp your body badly and you can do a lot of harm if you try to go too fast and end up injuring yourself. So please practice corseting responsibly and be safe. And if you guys have any other questions or requests about what else happens in the body when you're corseting, please feel free to send me a private message or leave a comment below. I'll get right back to you. Thanks a lot, guys.